Okay, folks, so we'll get started. Professor Quintier is someone that probably doesn't need any introduction. Rafael already, I guess, provided one for him already. But for those of you who aren't, haven't met Jim, Jim spent quite a few years working both at NIST as well as the University of Maryland in their fire protection engineering department. He is a guru in the field. So much of a guru that I use his textbook all the time when I teach fire behavior. He's just an incredible person that brings a wealth of knowledge to the issues at hand. And so today we'll be hearing from him about his review, involvement, his take on the NIST investigation, and particularly the issues of structural fire resistance. So without further ado, Jim, take it away.
Thank you. I would say you should really dwell on Dr. Terrero's talk for the future. My talk is a look at the past. And although it's a pleasure to be here at John Jay College and to see old friends and make new acquaintances, it's really not a pleasure to give this talk because I've given it many times, either in a bar or on a stage, and sometimes I can't get shut off. Because I feel that things were done incorrectly and probably slipshod. And probably the design of the World Trade Center with regard to fire safety was also in that category. Now, someone sent me this the other day. Well, actually, they didn't send it to me because they know that I don't agree with it, but are there any people from the Architect and Engineers for 9/11 Truth in the audience? No? You could identify yourself, don't be afraid. All right, so sometimes they show up, but these people are very well organized, they have support, and they put out a slick brochure like this, advocating that the building was taken down, both of them, all of them, 1, 2, and 7, by controlled demolition. They look at what NIST did in the investigation, and I might say that NIST never would have been able to do that if it wasn't for Sally and Monica Gabriel speaking out and getting Congress to listen, and finally they funded an organization to do this study a year after it occurred. Any other country in the world would have had an immediate team of experts on this from day one. I don't know, we're a democracy, I guess. We have to wait until the Congress acts. So, I'm going to cite some things from their report and from some other sources that I was involved in. But one of the things that they do here is they cite some people at NIST. Now, for those of you that don't know, NIST is the National Institutes for Standards and Technology. They got a $20 million contract from the government, a grant to study why the building fell down with the fire in the airplane. The 9/11 Commission, that was offline to them. The 9/11 Commission had a sunset time. They had to end in about a year and a half. NIST could go on forever. Their investigation took longer than World War II. And they didn't even get to World Trade Center 7 in that time period. So they had a lot of hearings, but you could see that after a couple of years, the interest level goes down, the reporters stop coming. James Glantz, one of the key reporters, went off to Iraq because that was much more interesting. And no one showed up at their workshops except Sally, Monica, maybe Philip Warren. Glenn was on their advisory panel. Jose mentioned somebody that was on their advisory panel that told me, I think it was into year three, that the structural engineers were having trouble calculating that the building could fall down, that it something wasn't going right. That's all he said. I mean, he didn't get into detail. But the structural people at NIST were, in particular, Teresa McAllister and John Gross. They headed the structural part of this. And NIST contracted with two firms. So this organization, the architects and engineers, they cite these people as key people in this flawed investigation. So McAllister, John Gross, then Ronald Hamburger, whose firm was awarded the contract for 1 and 2, and then Ramon Gilsons, who did it for World Trade Center 7. Why they gave it to a commercial firm and gave most of their money away, when MIT and the University of Edinburgh, noted institutions that had a real passion and interest in this field and the expertise, lost the contract to some commercial firm that didn't know anything about fire, I wonder. So right away, there's like a flag. What the heck is going on? World Trade Center 7, probably Jose's not at liberty to tell you the issues there because you worked for a lawyer. So that information never comes to light. The World Trade Center was the first national disaster where the federal government paid people not to hire a lawyer. Now, usually when things like this happen, when you hire a lawyer, the general public may never know, but the people who hear the case do find out what the heck went wrong. And then, you know, judgment is rendered. One thing that the architects say in this thing, they say that FEMA and NIST found no evidence to support that the fires caused the problem. I mean, or the diesel fires caused the problem. NIST, because they couldn't take the building down due to the fire that they calculated, had to go to an assumption. Now, the NIST response is it's not an assumption. They calculated it based on how much damage would be done to gypsum board. So it was still theoretical. What they did is they removed insulation from the core columns. So the core columns were basically naked, and now those columns could get hot. They didn't blame it on the rest of the structure, the external columns getting hot, the trusses getting hot. It was the core columns that basically got hot because the insulation was removed. Well, if that's true, the airplane did it. The airplane stopped the fire, removed the insulation, there's no more protection, brought the building down. However, if you look at it a different way, if that wasn't the case and the airplane did not remove the insulation, then the insulation that the building had may not have been adequate. And that leads you to a whole different conclusion about what should be done and what should be looked at and who should be held responsible. I pay attention to what new information comes out, and there's always around the anniversary of 9/11 a new documentary. There was one I saw by the Smithsonian Channel. You might have seen it. Two people, one guy from New York, a physicist, another man from Finland, calculated the time of collapse, and they just calculated based on one floor falling on the next, on the next, on the next, on the next. So one floor fell, then it was too heavy, then two floors fell. And they calculate that by basic physics, no really, you know, computer model. And they showed they could predict the times. So they said, these people that say controlled demolition are totally wrong. If one floor starts to fall, this building is going to fall the way it did. And they make that calculation, and Smithsonian Channel supports them. And the Smithsonian Channel also takes NIST to task on their assumption that the core columns had the insulation removed by the airplane. NIST provided no comment. So up to that point, I thought this was a really good documentary. Then they go off and they say that somehow aluminum in the building melted. And there may have been aluminum in the building from the airplane that did melt, because there was some shiny stuff flowing out of the building in one of the video things. So there may really be, because there's a lot of aluminum in that airplane. So it may have melted, but they say somehow it found water in a sprinkler system, and then it set off a big explosion. But anyone that looks at those videos, you can see minor puffs coming out of the floors before the building collapsed completely in a catastrophic sense. But you don't see anything that amounts to a controlled explosion or a big explosion like you would get from a kinetic chemical reaction. Let me move on and go through this report from the architects and engineers. They say NIST produced remarkably little evidence to support its claim that fireproofing dislodgement significantly affected the structures. So they even key in on that. They also say that NIST got a lot of steel, a lot, what was left over. And NIST finally tested this metallurgically. They didn't test it metallurgically until year 3. Before that, they were looking at the paint to see whether the paint blistered on the steel. Glenn, you might confirm that?
Yes.
They were just looking at the paint to see if it blistered as some indication of temperature. And they did not know in the fire and building field that you could do a metallurgical test on steel and tell what temperature it got to. Now, if they got steel from the key areas where the fire took place, from the core, they would have proved or disproved their hypothesis that the core got hot. In fact, when they finally did do the metallurgical analysis, and why did they do it? Finally, someone asked the metallurgical people from NIST to do it. Needless to say, I was asking them for 3 years. And although I worked there, as Jose already indicated, I get no respect. So NIST found that out of 170 areas that they tested, they found only 3 locations that bore evidence of the steel reaching temperatures above 250 degrees C. That's about 500 F. So that's insignificant to do anything to the steel. So these guys sort of get on some of this stuff. They also say at the end of this whole thing, this is like their conclusion, did NIST provide extraordinary evidence to support its hypothesis? And they said the answer is no. NIST fell far short of providing extraordinary evidence. And then they say, not for lack of trying or lack of resources or lack of expertise, but because there is no evidence to support the hypothesis of fire-induced failure. That's what these guys say. I say that they're wrong, and I say the credit they give to NIST about resources and expertise is also wrong. Because at the last workshop they had, I was so frustrated that I almost didn't go. And finally, they let me talk. And my stuff is in the record someplace at NIST. And I said that they produced this remarkable 10,000-page document where they had 200 people working for 5 years on just World Trade Center 1 and 2, and that's kind of extraordinary in itself. But unfortunately, the document is flawed, and it's either due to the fact that the scientists there have very low morale, and they passed this thing on from one scientist to another and didn't want to get involved, or that the management is incompetent, which is probably true, because the management that heads these programs are not scientists, in the words that Jose and I would use. Or thirdly, the lawyers stood in their way, because unlike a civil case where the lawyers would advocate for information, the lawyers in the Commerce Department basically blocked information. NIST had subpoena power. They didn't have one hearing where they subpoenaed anyone. And there are things lurking out there that never got flushed. So how did I get involved in this? Well, when 9/11 happened, I was about to teach a course in Georgia for the ATF. Obviously, they closed the compound there. I didn't get on until much later. The ATF were going to New York to the Pentagon to assist, and they asked me if I wanted to ride up with them. I said, no, I'll take the plane tomorrow. Maybe you forgot. There were no planes tomorrow. There were no planes after that for about 2 weeks. So I missed out. The ATF did go up to the Pentagon. They worked with the FBI. They had a big fight on the third day. ATF was kicked out and told not to come to New York. And the NTSB, who usually invests aircraft accidents, were told, this is a terrorist attack. FBI has it. Just forget about it. So FBI had the responsibility. So I went back to my work, paid attention. And then somebody put me on this FEMA committee organized by the civil engineers. And then they were going to go to New York. No, like in 2 weeks. They put another one of my colleagues on too, but they put him on the first team. They said I was on the second team, and they kept me informed. So I was getting all the email. And the email said that they were discarding the steel. And there was someone on their committee, Sally, these people know, Professor Stani from Berkeley, who went out to the dump site and was trying to make sense out of the steel. The civil engineers of New York, they went out there too, but nothing systematically was done with that steel. If this is a real fire investigation, this is called spoliation. Any prosecutors or lawyers in the audience? Anyone know what spoliation means? Spoliation means you're at a fire scene and you start doing stuff to the scene so that the evidence is not admissible anymore because you've tampered with it. Now, when you take away the steel and the steel is marked in chalk and in metal embossing that tells you where it came from in the fire, at least the main structure, you would take that and put it in a separate pile so you could analyze it later and see what the heck happened. That was not done. It was sold to Korea and its artifacts all around the country now. That may be nice as a memorial, but why did this happen? Where were the people in New York? I wrote to the Department of Building and Design. There's I have copies of the letter. They ignored me. So I heard that the National Science Foundation had given money to scientists like a days after 9/11 to do a quick study and find the answers. And then a month or two later, at the end of November, they had a conference in New York. So I asked if I could come. I didn't have a grant. They said I could come. I got my train ticket. I'm ready to go. Packed my suitcase. I get a call from the NSF lady. Sorry, you're not allowed to come anymore. Why? Maybe she read my article in the Baltimore paper because I wrote an op-ed. So she said I can't come. Gene Corley, who headed that group, I contacted him because I was still affiliated, and he got me to come. They said I could come, but I couldn't ask any questions. I did ask questions, and then that's how I got involved in this whole thing, because There used to be a radio show by Mr. Meltzer. Anyone remember that show in New York?
WOR.
It was one of my mother's favorite shows. Mr. Meltzer somehow tracked me down and interviewed me by phone, and I think Sally must have heard it. So she called me up days later and said, would I want to get involved? And I said, yes, of course. And so it started on this journey of really seeking the truth. Eventually, NIST got, you know, this contract that Sally and others got the money for from Congress. You wonder why, when Congress had their last hearing at the Science and Technology Committee, that the first speaker was Sally, and the second speaker was NIST and a bunch of other people. You have to go back and look at that testimony. So there's some issues here, and Jose knows that I put out publications early doing simple calculations. I even went to Isolatec, who supplied the insulation, and they let me do tests there for free. So I had a deep interest, and I followed the NIST investigation closely. I must say I was disappointed. I was hopeful. But then at the end, when they came up with this ridiculous claim that the insulation of the core columns was taken away, and I have something on that. I'll come back to it. But it's something like, in the numbers like this, in the South Tower, something like 39 of 47 columns had their insulation stripped. And in the North Tower, it was something like 41 out of 48 columns had their insulation stripped. That's a lot of stripping from that airplane, particularly when the wheels and the engines went right through the building. It probably didn't hit anything. So it's very dubious. I'm going through things step by step. The main issue I have with NIST, and the most critical one, deals with something Jose said. You had that fire resistance curve where you had time and temperature, and then you had how long the fire lasts. So that depends on the fuel load. The fuel load NIST was using was very, very low. It's like at the end of the spectrum of fuel loads that have been measured for buildings. I always wondered about that. Finally, by some mysterious means, I got the blueprints, the architectural drawings for the Marsh McLennan floor. I got the names of some people that knew people on that floor. And I had to send the drawings back, but I looked at them. And then I had a very knowledgeable person. Now, you could attest to this or say she's a screwball. But Kate Stewart, she's what?
Really good.
Kate Stewart, one of our students, volunteered to look at the plants. And she had this knowledge of plan review. So fire protection engineers really know how to do plan review. They look at all the stuff and they know what's going in the building. And she could track it down to the manufacturer. And she called the manufacturer. She got all the fuel, the weights of the combustibles. We put them all in. And I said, compared to what NIST said, because NIST had the same drawings. The fuel load's about the same. But I said, consider the extraneous stuff. So she added that in. Then she comes to me one day and she says, look at this. There's file cabinets. I think it was like, I have the number someplace, but it's like four draw 170 file cabinets, which NIST did not include. Then I call up people who knew people on that floor. A security guard said that they were cited on Marsh McLennan floor for too much paper. They had paper all over the windowsills. It's interesting. There's a lot of video early on where paper's flying all over the place after this building was hit. I talked to someone who knew a vice president. Probably those people died. And she said that they were paper hogs. They never threw anything away. That's what the vice president had told her. They never throw anything away. So this is Marsh McLennan floor. So when we calculated the new fuel load, it was 2 to 3 times what NIST had. NIST fires, by their computer model, are over, I think they're like about 800 to 1,000 degrees for 15 or 20 minutes. That's a very, very short time, because you have to be over that temperature. That after that, they were less than 500 degrees. So if you're less than 500 degrees and you have adequate insulation, you're not heating the steel up to anything that it's going to weaken with. So NIST fires were very, very short. They claim that they're accurate. When I told NIST about the fuel load and I sent them a long document, I didn't even get a letter back. I got a courtesy call from a friend who said that the NIST people said that paper does not burn in file cabinets. Now, then I went off and talked to fire investigators, and they said, it's usually when they open up the drawer, it's all burned. So I did my own test, and yes, it burns. It's metal cabinet, and if it was wood cabinet, you would have a bigger fuel load. The metal cabinet gets hot, it distorts, you see flames coming out of it, and there's a lot of char left because it's low ventilation burning, but 60% of it is gasified. And the char probably still stays hot because it's glowing in there. So this still blows me off. Here's another issue that I thought, even without the fuel load, is extremely, extremely critical. It stands out there like a sore thumb. When the building was designed, the trusses had a specification of 1/2 inch of sprayed on insulation. These are the round trusses, the 1-inch trusses. 1/2 inch. Joe DeBono, who put this stuff on, put on 3/4. That was pretty good. But there was some asbestos in it, and some fell off. So 30 years later, they had a reinvestigation, and they sued Joe DeBono's company and Isolatec, and they won $40 million to fix the problem. So at that time, the new chief engineer said, let's take a look at this. And they took a look at it, and they went to the fire test codes, because the way these guys do it is they don't do a test necessarily. They go to UL listing and they say, this looks like the structure we're building. UL says it should have 1/2 inch of insulation. That's fine with us. Okay. That's probably what they did in the 60s. But why doesn't someone go back and try to discover what that whole rationale was? I mean, you're a firefighter in the audience. There was a firefighter that testified in New York that he remembers when that stuff was going on and the building was being built. And the firefighters were told to stay away. Don't come snooping around here. The Port Authority has this under control. And if you don't want to swim with the fishes, just keep doing your... Yeah, you could sleep with them or swim with them but it's hard when you have, I mean. But why didn't anyone look at the reasoning behind that? Then what they picked is they picked that it should be 1.5 inches. But if they had looked further in the code, the deck was not insulated. So they should have picked 2 inches. Well, the engineers in Port Authority that were getting this stuff sprayed on, every time a floor became unoccupied and they could go in there and redo it, didn't like this job. So they even contracted with a British firm to tell them that the half inch was adequate. And they, the British firm did a whole study. It was actually in 2001 where the study was produced. And the British firm said it was sort of accurate. It's okay. It's okay. Anyway, they kept going with it. Now, the 1/2 inch that was supposedly put on the Marsh McLennan floors, as opposed to the 3/4 inch in the South Tower, which was totally a different occupancy, so why should the fuel load be the same? NIST said it was, but I don't see how a trading floor has the same fuel load as Marsh McLennan floors. There was no effort to reproduce the fuel load of the trading floors. This is adequate investigation? I don't think so. Anyway, NIST acknowledged that installed the South Tower had 3/4, but the North Tower, which was supposed to get upgraded to 1.5, had 2.5. And NIST used in their calculations 2.2 inches for the trusses in the North Tower. What the heck justification was that? Why? Port Authority told them that's what, how much they had. They sent them a letter. Just contemplate this. You could be a layperson and you could understand this. Would you say that both fires were about the same in the two buildings after the airplane hit and realizing that the fuel load from the airplane burns out in 10 minutes? After that, it was furniture fires. Both fires were about the same. Multiple floors. If the South Tower had 3/4 inch of insulation on the trusses and the North had 1.5 inches and the South fell in 56 minutes and the North in 102, does something kind of connect up there? If I do a calculation that's very simple, and I calculate that the South Tower trusses got to temperatures where the steel becomes like soft spaghetti in about 56 minutes, and the North would be about 100 minutes, is that a coincidence? Well, some of the newspaper reporters thought it was because I was using just a simple calculation and other people were using computer models. We published a paper early on. It was published in 2002. Jose's Journal, Fire Safety Journal, gave us some courtesy. It's ignored, but I did get a call from Leslie Robertson when the paper came out. And we had a discussion, and he said, I had something wrong in the paper. There's not a blackboard here, but if you just consider the trusses are held at either end by these little brackets, and they're bolted. Now, Leslie Robertson said, no, they were welded also. So probably welded on this side of the flange and bolted here to the trusses. So when the truss starts to soften, and this goes like this, the only thing holding this is the bolt in shear now. That's not a very strong connection. There was a calculation done by a structural engineer from the UK, Sheffield, very early on that said that connection fails. There was another calculation done by NIST, said the connection fails. We said probably those connections failed and it fell down when it softened. In the NIST test in UL, those things softened and went like this. NIST said they passed the test because they didn't fall down to the floor. But they failed the test based on temperature. Based on thermal means, they failed the test. It's a nuance of how they did the test. They said they weren't looking at temperature. So I have issues. One last thing. My time is like 5 minutes.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. NIST published a 10,000-page article. When Sally testified, the Congress said, please don't send us that thing. Send us something like 50 pages so we could read it. So they did. If you find the root cause of a disaster, you should be able to explain it in a few pages, and even scientifically in a few pages, once you get to the root cause. I challenge anyone to find the root cause in the 10,000 pages. If you read carefully what NIST says, they say something different every time. One time they said this core column softened. Another time they said, they say the trusses pulled in the exterior columns. Certainly that did happen. They did buckle. Jose's colleague and people at Edinburgh made a calculation, said they would buckle. So maybe I don't have everything right, but I've been haunted by this because no one looks at some of these issues. Now, Glenn was on the advisory panel. Some people on that advisory panel resigned. One of them in particular, I think, didn't like the investigation and spoke off the record to a French news team who did a documentary on this. I know that because they spent a day at his house, and they told me that he was speaking off the record, so they couldn't videotape him, but they did videotape me. German TV did a documentary on this, and they videotaped me in a casino in Atlantic City. You didn't know that, but it was, if you ever go to Germany and see that documentary, you could say that that was taken in the Tropicana casino. About 2 years ago, NIST finally published their 10,000-page document. They excerpted from it, and they published it in the Journal of Fire Technology. So they had a special issue on the World Trade Center published in Fire Technology. One was on the fire. Two articles were on the structure. Then there were ancillary articles. And the editor sent me a copy, an email, early on before it was even like in print. And he said, probably you want to comment on this. So I did. And I also asked a colleague who was on the advisory panel, a noted combustion scientist, Foreman Williams, who I learned, and I only learned this because somebody made a little documentary in the U.S. and put him on it, that he agreed with some of the same issues I did. And he was on their panel. And when he was on their panel, he told me he was trying to do his best to make sure NIST came out right. But obviously at the end, he was disturbed. And so he had some of the same ideas as I. So we got together and we put through a response, a letter to the editor. A lot of drama there. The editor, Jose knows. Anyway, it didn't get published in that journal. It took about a year before we finally got to an endpoint with that journal, and the only way it was going to get published is if half of the article was redacted. So my colleague said, no way. We went to a different journal, and then NIST answered. So it's out there in the public domain now. What we think went wrong with NIST, and what their answers are. I mean, I look at their answers, and their answers just don't address what we said, and they don't hold much water. So you could see probably why I'm frustrated. I really think that some traction should be achieved. And it's not that I want to blast my colleagues at NIST and say, you idiots, you did it wrong. They did screw up. And if I'm wrong, you know, at least address it. At least go back and look at the fuel load NIST and say his fuel load, Quinteri's fuel load is wrong. At least go back and, you know, can the airplane really knock off that insulation? At least prove something a little more substantial. With all the money NIST had, they had enough money to do a full-scale test of one floor, and they didn't do that. And when Jose shows those temperatures on the time temperature curve, if you have a building that's so big as the World Trade Center on one floor, when you have fires in the center, it's very difficult for the heat to get lost by radiation. So what that means is that the temperatures can be much hotter. So in these large office buildings, open plan construction, non-compartmented construction, I think when you get a floor involved, you can have temperatures well in above of 1200 degrees C. You could have temperatures a lot hotter than people consider. I think maximum is 1,500, but obviously there was no steel melted. I think that's like a cap. But I think 1,200 to 1,300, it would not. I would not be surprised by seeing that from such. In large pool fires, just in the open, you can get those temperatures in the core. So why not in a fire that's just as expensive? After the heat gets lost to the surroundings, you know, then it's adiabatic. There's no more heat loss. So anyway, I ranted enough.
Ended, Jim, thank ended, you so much. Ended. One man's rant is another man's truth, right? So there we go. So any quick questions for Jim?
I just had a point of information, and you know, Jim, you know, referred to me a few times, and I have to say that the reason that I was able to get involved with, you know, trying to find out what happened and trying to save, you know, future people, certainly firefighters, but to try to help to save the public from this conspiracy of silence, from this conspiracy of don't ask, don't tell, why 3,000 people met a needless and brutal death that could have been and should have been avoided. But the only reason that I became involved is because I read, right after 9/11, everyone was so horrified by what happened that nobody was really thinking of, there has to be an investigation. How did the largest and tallest buildings in the world designed to hold the largest amount of people in the world, they were designed to hold 50,000 people per building. How did they collapse in seconds? How did this happen? How in the world, this is a civilized country. You wouldn't expect that in a third world country, but certainly not in the supposedly greatest country in the world. I tried to reach out to elected officials, which is the worst thing you could ever do if you want to really change anything. But finally, I read an article in the Daily News, and it said two professors from John Jay College call for a further investigation. I couldn't believe it that someone else besides myself and other concerned people felt that we needed an investigation. And so I finally met Professor Glenn Corbett and Charles Jennings. We got together, we talked about it, and my eyes were opened, and I was horrified to find out all of these issues that we're talking about, issues that were allowed to exist mainly because of the Port Authority of New York and New Jersey, an evil empire that is totally exempt and immune from all New York City building and fire codes. That was really the basis of this. And of course, I found out so much. And Jim, I wish I did hear your interview on NPR, but it was Charles and Glenn who really put me together with you. And because of Glenn Corbett and Charles Jennings and John Jay College, they knew experts from all over the country. Experts, you know, on fire, experts on construction, experts on evacuation, which you'll hear a very expert person this afternoon in addition to Jose and to Jim, who gave wonderful presentations. That's how I found them. I was just the face of 9/11 and, you know, the face of the loss. And I had to be out there because the public can't really absorb all of, you know, what you've heard. I certainly couldn't absorb it either. They were great teachers. That's why I sound like I know what I'm talking about, you know, over the years. You're only really as good as your teachers. But it was them, people like them, and people like several of the other people in the audience who are going to speak, people of ethics. And what I must say is I approached a lot of people who, off the record, shared our feelings, but, you know, they were afraid of getting fired and so on. Thank God for academic freedom, okay? Thank God for tenure, because the people that I hooked up with were all academic people, from Berkeley, California, from to Maryland, and to all of the other people. Most of them had the academic tenure, and this is the only reason that they could speak out. So you brought up so many things, Jim, but we share the feeling that the investigation was terrible, and so was the 9/11 Commission, by the way, but we can't go into that. The last point is I want to make about the fireproofing, and you know, just correct me if I'm wrong. That fireproofing, the way to prior to the building of the World Trade Center, which, keep in mind, was exempt and immune from all building and fire codes, they have their own codes, which no one has ever seen, by the way, even though I demanded it many times. But prior to that construction, there were other means of fireproofing that classic buildings were constructed, that were used, other means of fireproofing. The spray on fireproofing was, they called it innovative, I call it unorthodox. And before they applied that fireproofing to the largest and tallest buildings in the world, holding the most people, it was never tested. In this, the NIST investigation, we demanded proof to see what the testing was. There was no proof. There was no testing. Finally, they had to reluctantly admit that it was never tested. And that's something that history has to record. That's something, all of the things that are brought up, history has to record this, because this is something that never should have happened. The buildings never should have been constructed that way. And in the end, the truth is the most important thing, so that we're not going to do it again. I can't guarantee to you that we're not going to do it again, because nobody really paid attention to all of the failures of 9/11. Thank you.
Could I just? Sorry.
Yeah. Thanks. Thank you, Sally.
I think the insulation is key, and it would have, if it had the proper insulation, I do not believe those buildings would have fallen down. We just would have had a burned out building, maybe with some structural damage. The sprayed-on insulation that I tested at Solotech, that was the supplier company, I assumed it was similar, that's a good product if it's put on sufficiently. So I think that's – is that, I don't know what that is. Sorry. So – but –
I shut off my phone.
What do I have to do? No, it's here. Please stop. Oh, it's my, I'm sorry. I'm supposed to be on a conference call at noon. But this area is very sensitive, really sensitive. We had trouble with the journal putting our letter in. I wrote an article for the S&P magazine that the only way it got published early on was 50% of it was redacted. And they're bored. redacted it, not the editor. When we put out our letter to the editor, you would think a university would put out a press release that two scientists are questioning the investigation by NIST. Our university said it was too political to put out a press release.
Thank you, Jim. There's a lot to absorb. Thank you, Sally, for your remarks. And I can say, I think I speak on behalf of all the experts of various stripes who coalesced around Sally. And Jim was certainly pivotal in terms of his background in fire protection engineering, is that it was Sally's moral authority which enabled any of this to go anywhere, because as an individual expert, my head is flat on one side for banging it for the last 20 plus years against the walls here in New York City. And so really, I want to thank Sally for that.